Hey friend, welcome to the Branding with Jade podcast. I'm Jade, also known as the Aussie Adventuress, and I left the high-flying corporate world to chase my dreams and build an online business. Now, my biggest passion is teaching you how to get paid to be yourself doing what you love. If you want my secrets on all things personal branding, marketing, entrepreneurship, and making money doing what you love, then lovely, you are in the right place. Let's go. Hello, hello, and welcome to this week's episode of the Branding with Jade podcast. So I just got home from the hairdresser where I did a super exciting thing. I dyed my hair pink today. Now, if you follow me anywhere on social media, you've probably seen me talking about this before, how this is something I've been wanting to do for so many years. Actually, when I was in high school, I accidentally had it done and I was pretty mortified because it wasn't cool back then. And it literally happened not long before my school yearbook photos were taken. So I had pink hair in the yearbook. Thankfully, they were published in black and white. So back then I was quite happy about that. Now I actually wish it was in color because I'd love to see my hair because I don't really have a lot of pictures of it from then, but I just know how upset I was that my hair had turned pink. And now, who would have known all those years later that I would actually be trying so hard to turn my dark brown hair a pink color and that it would take forever? So firstly, I wanted to do it about 6 years ago, but I didn't follow through because it was when I was still working in the corporate world and I felt like I wouldn't be taken seriously in my role. Then once I quit my job, I kept trying only to give up halfway through the lightening process and end up dyeing it dark again and then having to start the whole process again. So today I was pretty thrilled when the hairdresser said we could do it in one go. Now, it's not as bright as I would ultimately like it to be, but it's a start. There is pink in my hair, and that makes me so happy. Now, you might be thinking, oh my God, Jade, why are you telling me about your hair? What does this have to do with branding? And why are you sharing this with me? Now, there's actually a very good reason, and that's because today we're going to be talking about one of my favorite topics, and that's color psychology and what this means for your personal brand. Say what? You're thinking? There's psychology behind colors? Well, yes, my lovelies. You may not realize it, but significant research goes into the design and color schemes of your favorite brands. The aesthetic elements are not decided on a whim. The color palettes, shapes, fonts, and even the line structures of the world's most recognizable brands and logos are decided based on simple psychology. And when it comes to your personal branding, this shouldn't be any different. If you truly want to stand out and build a memorable brand, you need to be paying attention to these really important details. Now, don't worry if you're stressing going, oh my God, I haven't thought about any of this stuff. I can tell you when I first started building my brand, I had no idea about the importance of colors and fonts and all of that kind of stuff. My branding was higgledy-piggledy and there was no consistency anywhere. But once my brand started getting traction, I knew it was time to up-level. This business was no longer just something I was doing for fun. It was my livelihood and I needed to start taking it seriously. So I wanted to up my game and in order to do that, I needed to look a certain way. That's when I invested in professionals. I started reading books, buying courses, working with photographers and videographers, website designers, graphic designers, all of those things to ensure that my brand looked premium to match the high level of service that I provide. And now when you come across my brand on any one of my social media channels, you'll instantly know it's mine because the colors, font, and overall design style have the same look and feel. There's complete consistency everywhere I put content. Now, I could go on and on about every single design element that makes up your personal brand, but we'll literally be here for hours. So today, let's just focus on colors, as I believe that's definitely the most important of these elements. In fact, research reveals that people make a subconscious judgment about a person, environment, or product within 90 seconds. And I believe that's actually less now. I think it's something like 1.5 seconds. It just keeps going down and down because people's attention spans are becoming less and less as they are overloaded with so much content these days. So they are making split-second decisions based on you without really getting to know you. And a lot of that comes down to color. In fact, between 62% and 90% of their initial subconscious judgment of you is based on color alone. Now, I'm going to share a link to more of these stats in the show notes because, as you know, I'm a kind of a nerd for stats and I find it quite fascinating. So if you want to have a look at those, you can go and check it out at the link in the show notes. There's heaps of different stats about colors and the psychology behind them. And I think it's quite interesting. So you might be interested in that too. So basically, that's what brand color psychology is. It's the subconscious judgment that people are making based on the colors they're using. And it's the study of how colors impact the way we perceive brands. Colors have a really powerful effect on our emotions, and these emotions play a major role in how we behave as consumers. And basically, brand color psychology provides a framework for understanding how and why we interact with the brands in our lives. Now, while the effect that colors have on our emotions can differ from person to person based on our genders, cultural context, personal experiences, and neurological variances, there are some general guidelines that have come out of countless studies on color psychology. And if you have a good understanding of these guidelines, that gives you one more tool in the underlying goal of creating a more powerful personal brand. So now that we understand what color psychology is, let's talk about the meanings behind some of the most popular colors. And I'm also going to include a link to a diagram that depicts this, so you'll be able to get access to that in the show notes as well, because there's more colors that I'm not going to be talking about, and I think it's good to see a visual representation rather than just hearing somebody talking about it. So if you want to see the visual diagram of the colors and the positive and negative emotions that are attached to them, you can go to my show notes and you'll be able to find that diagram. Now, let's get into the colors and let's start with red. So if we think about some of the positive associations to this color, it's things like power, energy, strength, excitement. But on the flip side, some negative associations include anger, danger, warning, and pain. Now, red can be considered the most stirring of colors. Its effects on the psyche are not subtle. It's therefore important that it be used carefully for branding purposes. Red has been shown to reduce analytical thinking, so it speeds up and intensifies our reactions, which is why there's a reason why sale prices and price tags and online marketing sales pages are put on red, because it entices fast action. But if you think of the flip side, red can be associated with a lot of negative things like war, like Nazism, communism, all of that kind of stuff, where red is a really powerful color, but there's negative associations to that. So that's why when we see red, we think quickly. We want to get past it quickly because it's making us not think properly. It's speeding up and intensifying our reactions because it's such a powerful color. So when you use that color, it's probably best to use it sparingly, but use it in the smart way, and you can really get some powerful actions that happen from using that color. Now, the next color to consider is orange. So this is next on the spectrum compared to red. And some of the positive associations to this color include courage, warmth, innovation, and energy. And then some negative associations include frustration, frivolity, immaturity, and ignorance. Now, orange conjures up feelings of excitement, enthusiasm, and warmth. It's a fun, energetic hue and is a color that is used to draw attention. Think of like your high-vis outfits and traffic cones and all of that kind of stuff where orange is really there because it stands out, it attracts attention. But it's also a color that consumers tend to associate with value. And so a lot of brands tend to capitalize on this. And I'm going to refer to banking because that's the world I come from. But this was a really popular color in Australian banks. And it came in like how long was I at the bank? 10 years. And it was about 3 or 4 years into my career at the bank that we did a big rebrand. Because when I started at Bankwest, our main color was blue. And then after working there for a while, our colors became, we rebranded to be completely orange. We reopened all our new stores and we made them completely orange. And it's a super bright, bold color that draws you in, attracts attention. The blue kind of blends in with everything else around it, whereas the orange really stands out. And this is something that ING uses as well, and lots of other banks seem to use it too. So it's something that is warm and appealing, and because of that perception of value, banks want to be seen as a valuable institution. They want their customers to feel comfortable going there and to see the value in using them. So it's a color that makes sense for those brands to use. So it's bright, it's inviting, it's memorable. Now, the next color on the spectrum is yellow, and some positive associations to this color include warmth, happiness, creativity, and intellect, but then some negative associations include irrationality, fear, anxiety, and frustration. Now, according to research, yellow actually has the smallest fan club, but in terms of people that want to use it in their branding, but those who do like it are passionate about their preference. And because it's not such a common one, it could be a good thing to use because you'll stand out. And it's widely considered a cheerful hue because of its links to sunshine and summer. But on the flip side, too much yellow can also trigger feelings of anger, frustration, fear, and anxiety. And this is because it's the most difficult color to take in. I don't know if you've tried to type with yellow font on your computer and you can barely read it, and it can almost be blinding at times depending on the shade, and so that can cause frustration. If you're trying to read a yellow font or you're trying to understand something or look at this bright yellow and it's just kind of blinding you, then that's going to frustrate you and it's going to make you want to turn away. And if things are too hard to take in, people will likely not bother. So it's important to think about whether yellow is right for your brand. Now let's look at green. So some positive associations to this color include health, hope, nature, and prosperity. And some negative associations include boredom, envy, blandness, and sickness. Now the color green is the easiest on our eyes because it requires no adjustment when it hits the retina. It's therefore calming, restful, and pleasing. Green is also the color of balance and it represents nature and fertility. But like all colors, green also has its negative side. It's the symbol of health, but also the symbol of sickness. When you see like the green emoji, that's the sick face. And when you look at things like it represents luck, like the Irish luck and the four-leaf clover and all of that. But on the other side, it also represents jealousy. She's green with jealousy, that kind of thing. So it really depends how you look at it. And like we said at the start, color is all about perception and people's experiences with the color. So it can be positive, it can be negative, and it's up to you how you look at it and what your associations with the color are and what audience you're trying to attract as to whether they're going to think the same about it. If your brand is about nature and being outdoors and all of that kind of stuff, then it kind of makes sense to use green because the people that follow you are going to be outdoorsy and into that kind of stuff as well. So green will probably have positive connotations for them. So you need to think about that kind of thing. Now let's look at blue. Now some positive associations to this color include trust, loyalty, dependability, and security. And some negative associations include coldness, emotionless, unfriendliness, and uncaring. So blue is a color that evokes the mind. It's serene and calming, and it's the color of clarity and communication. But according to color psychology studies, blue has been shown to be the most common favorite color among the world's population, and is particularly preferred by men. So it's, of course, everywhere in our daily lives. It's the color of the sky, the oceans, and the lakes. And so this global preference and environmental omnipresence can make blue non-threatening, conservative, and traditional. So if you do choose to use blue in your branding, then it's not really taking a risk. It's seen as a sign of stability and reliability, and it's not really bold or stand out because it's a color that's everywhere. So, and on the flip side, it's also the color of sadness and coldness. So do you really want to be associated with that? Something else to consider. Now, I'll let you know one thing though. When I used to, before I went gung-ho on my pink branding, when I used to do sales pages with my Aussie Adventurous brand and on that Instagram account, I did use a lot of blue and green. And obviously that was more of a travel-related brand as well, and nature and outdoorsy, so ocean and forest and all of that kind of stuff. So people were naturally drawn to those colors that were looking at that account because they were all quite similar to me. But those sales pages did really well when I had green backgrounds and like green buttons on blue photos and that kind of thing. So it's always something to consider is who is your audience? What kind of things are they going to be attracted to? What's your brand about and what's going to work for your brand? Now let's consider purple. So some positive associations to this color include luxury, wealth, spirituality, and sophistication. And some negative associations include introversion, decadence, suppression, and extravagance. Now, purple is the color of royalty and bravery, and it implies wealth, luxury, and sophistication. It is also among the rarest colors in nature, so it can come across as either special or artificial. Now, purple sits in the shortest wavelength and it's the last to be visible. So for this reason, it's associated with time, space, and the cosmos. It's imbued with spirituality, contemplation, and meditation, suggesting creativity and imagination. And that's why you'll see like all the pictures of the universe and books that talk about the universe and abundance and the law of attraction and manifestation. They're all those purple kind of tones because that works with that. Now, let's consider magenta. So some positive associations to this color include imaginative, passion, creative, innovation, and some negative associations include outrageousness, nonconformity, impulsiveness, and eccentricity. Now, magenta is a color of emotional balance and physical harmony. It's sophisticated yet pragmatic. It's associated with feelings of self-respect and contentment, and it's a color of transformation, suggesting the ridding of old ideas and the embrace of new ones. Magenta retains a certain level of boldness from red and can therefore appear either outrageous and shocking or innovative and imaginative, depending on the context. So it's well suited to creative, nonconformist endeavors, which is why I love it so much. And finally, let's look at black and white. Firstly, black. Some positive associations to this color include sophistication, power, elegance, and authority. And some negative associations include oppression, coldness, evil, and mourning. So black is a symbol of power. It's a barrier color, so it absorbs energy and envelopes the personality. It's essentially the absence of light, which gives it its ominous overtones, and it stands for sophistication, weight, and seriousness. Black is timeless and effortlessly stylish, and if you think of things like the little black dress or a certain iconic black turtleneck that Steve Jobs always wore, you can think of these things and you can associate black with those feelings of power and sophistication, elegance, and simplicity. But while it's the color of sophistication, it's also the color of mourning. And this is why personally I don't like black for this reason, because I just associate it with funerals, especially when it comes to clothes. I love to wear a lot of colors because that makes me feel bright and happy. So when I come across brands that are bright and poppy, it makes me feel the same. Whereas if I come across black, I have to really be in the mood to see that. Otherwise, it can just put me off. Like, I think of black skies, gray skies, darkness, rain, all of that kind of stuff. And it's a gloomy kind of color to me. Whereas when partnered with white, I think black holds a lot of class, elegance, and sophistication. So when you think of high-end fashion labels like Chanel and Prada, where black and white are partnered together as the dominant colors, I think that works really well and it exudes simplicity and elegance. But black on its own, I personally am not a fan of. And so this is something to consider as well, is where is your audience primarily based? What's their, like, what could their religion be? Could they be associating black with funerals and mourning and that kind of stuff as well? What would black mean to your audience? And finally, as for white on its own, some positive associations to this color include purity, simplicity, sophistication, and freshness. And some negative associations include sterility, coldness, unfriendliness, and elitism. Now, white has long been a symbol of purity and innocence, and it's the color of blank slates, symbolizing freshness and new beginnings. White's association with marriage and wedding dresses is deeply entrenched in society. When you think of wedding, you think white. You think of new starts, new beginnings, all of that kind of stuff. And it's also really modern and sleek, leveraged by brands like Apple to denote a chic, sleek style. And basically, it's the most minimal of all the colors, so it creates a heightened perception of space. Now, there you have it. That is the psychology behind some of the main colors. Now, while each color has its own positive and negative connotations, at the end of the day, the most important thing to consider is, what do you want your brand to be known for? What is your overarching message, and what do you want people to feel when they come across your brand? So this goes back to the episodes where I talk about finding your why and understanding your purpose and all of that kind of stuff. Because if you don't know the message that you want your brand to convey, then it's hard for you to select the right colors, because you really need to understand what your message is to understand how the psychology of those colors is going to play into your branding and whether it's going to work for your message or not. So then think of the colors that will make people associate those feelings with your brand. So for instance, I picked magenta and pink as my primary colors. Now, magenta is basically a shade of pink, but I've got the magenta and then I've got the light pink and the baby pink. So I've got all the pinks, and then I throw a bit of shades of red in sometimes, and then I've got the black for my text and white as those kind of colors. But my primary colors that you will see all over my social media is the pinks. So magenta I use because of its links to transformation, creativity, and non-conformity, which are big values of mine. My whole ethos and mission is about helping people achieve freedom and create lives that they are really passionate about, and not having to conform to the ideals that society makes us think that we have to stick by, like working 9-to-5 jobs and all of that kind of stuff, and to really questioning the way the world works, and to really think about what drives you, what are you passionate about, what do you want to do with your life. So that is a powerful value and message of mine, and that is what that color evokes. And then this is used alongside lighter shades of pink because pink is a soft and thoughtful color. It's also become associated with all things feminine. It's a color that brings to mind traditionally feminine ideas like tenderness, youthful love, and vulnerability. And basically, I like those colors because I want to attract a primarily female audience. And I think of the accounts that I'm drawn to and the colors that they use, and pink is a color I'm drawn to. So it makes sense to use that color myself. Plus, pink is in all the places I love to go to, like my cafes, the the props I buy, everything I buy, I'm drawn to pink. And so it naturally makes sense to use that in my branding. And then sometimes I use shades of red. I don't want this to be my dominant color because of the connotations that go along with this. But when used sparingly, it does bring about feelings of passion and excitement and inspires fast action. Now, as I just said as well, these are the colors I'm naturally drawn to in other brands. So knowing that my ideal client is generally quite similar to me, it makes sense for me to use these colors knowing it would attract my ideal client. Now, also, a recent study of images that were most frequently shared on Pinterest found that warm colors like red, purple, and pink were by far more often shared on the site than other colors. So that suggests that brands that can use those colors can increase their shares on traditionally female-dominated social sites. And since my primary platforms are Instagram and Pinterest, which are female-dominated, it makes sense for me to use these colors since that's the audience I'm trying to attract. And I'll include a link to that study as well. So also, this is why I wear a lot of pink and red clothes and went as far as dyeing my hair pink because it represents my brand. And when people see pink, I want them to think of me. So the more I show up in this color, the more it will stick in people's minds. And it's quite interesting, actually, because I recently became friends with a girl we met around November last year through the network marketing company that I was working with, and we both joined that at the time, and it just so happened we both live on the Sunshine Coast, and so we started hanging out, and we basically meet up weekly for coffee and hangouts and that kind of stuff. And she obviously started to get to know me and get to associate me with the color pink. And she drove past this house the other day and she was like, "Oh my God, Jade, that house is perfect for you. You have to go look at it. I've never seen it before. It must have just been painted pink recently." And so we went to this house and we knocked on the door and asked if we could take photos there. And it turns out it's actually like a beauty salon and hair salon, so they didn't mind us doing it. But we asked them, "How long have you been there?" And they were like, 2 years. And my friend said she has driven down that street like every week for as long as she's lived here, which is over 2 years, and she's never noticed it before. But because she associates me with the color pink, something in her subconscious mind triggered her to notice that. This is my interpretation of it, of why she only started to notice it now, because she now thinks of that color and thinks of me. And so this is what colors can do. It can trigger people to think of you when they're not even around you. And that is what you want to do. You want to keep popping up in people's minds. You want to be front of mind. And so I also know this because I've noticed this in the brands that I know and love. And I am drawn to the accounts with pink. I'm drawn to girls with pink hair and wearing pink clothes and having pink photo shoots because I like the feelings that those colors draw up for me. And I want you to take a moment and think of some of your favorite accounts. Think of the colors they use. Think of the impact that has on you. Maybe even just write it down and do a bit of a journaling exercise on what kind of colors you're drawn to and what kind of emotions they bring up for you, what feelings, what associations, why you follow these people, what colors it is, what you like about what they do, and think about that kind of stuff. Think about what you're drawn to, what emotions do you want people to feel when they come across your content. These are the kinds of questions you should consider when you start looking at your own brand colors. So on that note, that concludes this episode. I really hope this has encouraged you to look at colors a little differently and to realize what a powerful branding tool they can be when you work with them effectively. And that's it for today. So as usual, thank you so much for listening. And if you haven't already done so, don't forget to subscribe so you get all the latest episode updates and even leave a review if you fancy, because I look forward to reading yours out next time. I love reading them out. So if you want to leave a review, go ahead and do that. Go ahead and subscribe and share it to your stories. Share it with people if you've enjoyed listening, because I really do just love talking about branding and helping people improve their personal branding. So if you've enjoyed this episode, please do share. Tag me on Instagram and I'll share it back to my stories, because I love sharing you out. I love creating this community feeling, and I just get so much enjoyment out of this. So thanks for tuning in, and I will chat to you again soon. Have a fabulous week, and don't forget, if you want to check out those stats and color emotion, go to the links in my show notes. Thank you, and I'll see you next week. Ciao for now.